Hello everyone, welcome to the fresh videocast episode of Cozy Conversations. So in the month of November, one very interesting thing that I noticed in my social media feed was that all my social media feed was like posted with wedding pictures. Either someone was getting married or someone was attending someone else's marriage. And then I thought that, okay, this would be a very interesting topic to cover, like talking about marriages, because marriage is an institution that I'm really fond of, as well as I'm very intrigued by this concept of marriage itself. So I felt like, okay, mujhe to isme cozy conversation karna hai. And now today we'll be talking about like arranged marriage versus love marriage. So we have two special guests here. The first guest is Dr. Pooja Jaiswal. So she's a consultant radiologist working at Patan Hospital, and she's been married for 20 years now. And on the other hand, we have Nisha Murarkadi. So she is working at Facts Nepal, and she just did her intercaste marriage 1.5 years ago. And you know, like, I somehow happened to know her husband, and when I saw their social media pictures of their wedding, I was like, okay, how did this happen? Like, how did intercaste marriage happen? Because in marriage community, like, even today, intercaste marriage is like a big no-no. So I really wanted to have this conversation with you to know your experiences, and I wanted to have a conversation with you to know your experiences in 20 years of marriage. So should we start?
Yes.
So what was the biggest hurdle that you guys have faced in the process of getting married, and in the whole like marriage itself, like what's the biggest hurdle that you guys have faced? Or who'd like to go first?
Okay. So Mahima, you are a very smart girl, huh? She's actually interviewing the two ladies, you know, arrange and law. She'll know everything. So all the secrets are open now. All right. So the biggest hurdle, see, for me, it was more of an inter-country marriage. I'm coming from North India, Dehradun, to Nepal, and I have never been here. So though we belong to the same caste, but when I came here, I could see there are a lot of, you know, cultural differences, a lot of differences, like in everything you can possibly imagine, from food to clothes to religion to everything, you know, the way they were doing things. And the other thing was the family background, you know, the approach of a family, you know. So I'm coming from a strict business family and then getting married into a bureaucrat family. And I'm the only doctor in my house. And of course, my father wanted me to marry a doctor. And I quite like the idea. So that was one thing. And the other one is like me being a doctor. I was like supposed to work, and at the same time I was expected to, you know, look after the domestic chores, not the hardcore domestic chores that I'm supposed to clean or cook or do stuff like that, but yes, of course, the final touch, you see. So there are a few incidences I would like to tell you. So once my mother-in-law, when I got married, she asked me, can you iron, you know, can you iron the clothes? So I said, yeah, I can. And then she gave me this very confusing dress. Now I know it's daura salwar. That time I had no clue what it is, you know, how to tie those knots and how to iron this and what kind of a dress is that. So they were like things, they were like quite different for me, but when I think of it now, it's like fine. For that period of time, it was different, you know. Like, I'm coming from North India, I've seen my mother doing Karwa Chauth, keeping the fast for my father, and here they are doing Tej. And then there was this trend of, you know, I have a sweet tooth, I'm very fond of eating dessert after every meal. So in India, it's like, it's the trend, it's kind of a trend, like you see, you eat a little bit of dessert, the, you know, sweet thing right after your meal. And here, this was not the trend, and this doesn't happen in Nepal, you know. This is the thing I was told. And the Nepali mithai was also quite different, you know. I haven't heard of all those yamari and lakamari and gundpak, you know. So they were like different things. They were very, very different in the beginning. Of course, later on, I get used to it. But yeah, they were like hurdles for me in the beginning. Yes. There were few.
So I believe that the fact that you came from a different country and you had to shift to an entirely new place was that transition phase was kind of very challenging.
Yes.
Just the little things in the transition phase were challenging.
Yeah.
So what about you?
The biggest hurdle is the intercaste aspect of my marriage. I belong to a Marwari community and my husband Uttam, he belongs to a Nepali Chhetri family. So you can imagine the extent of cultural difference in both of us, right? And like for me, the hurdle came in three phases. Before marriage, it was convincing my parents for intercaste marriage. During marriage, it was the rituals whether we should follow Nepali culture or Marwari culture. And now it's the cultural difference that I'm going through, and you can imagine like it's mainly a girl who has to face the cultural difference and adjust. So yeah, that has been the biggest hurdle for my marriage.
So yeah, talking about cultural shock, I believe that you also went through a cultural shock because yours was an inter-country marriage, but in an inter-caste marriage, like the cultural shock is huge because culture shapes like the way we think, the way we eat, the kind of clothes that we wear, everything is shaped by our culture. And you were supposed to like go and adapt to a new culture altogether. So how did you manage to take it, and like how did you deal with that phase?
So yeah, you're right. I had to face this cultural shock, and it's been like 1.5 years of my marriage and I'm still facing this cultural shock. So you know, when you say that you want to marry someone from another caste, you think you know that you are going to have a lot of differences, right? But knowing and actually experiencing it, these both are two different things. When you say you know it, you just see the tip of the iceberg. But when you actually get married, you see what's below the iceberg. So my this below the iceberg thing happened after I got married. Like there were so many differences from the time I woke up to the time I slept. Like the difference in the time I wake up, the food I eat, the dress I wear, jewelry, festivals, the way of greeting, there were so many differences. And honestly speaking, I'm not like, there was a lot of problem initially in dealing with this cultural shock. Like the first 6 months was completely disaster. Gradually things are getting better for me, and we both are trying to fit in each other culture. We are trying to respect each other culture. So yeah, things are getting better now, and I am being able to deal with this cultural shock.
So I believe one very important learning that I have from your answer is that it's completely two different things to have knowledge about something and to experience it.
Yeah.
Like having knowledge is good, like having knowledge of everything is good, but actually experiencing something like introduces you to the little challenges that you never thought of would occur. So that's why it's very important to experience things to really like, you know, and not just be limited by knowledge, but also experience things so that you can learn in a better way. So in your case, like that is one of the
You should take notes, huh? Mahima underneath the eyes.
Sure, I'm taking a lot of learnings from this episode. I believe that this episode will help me in the process
when
I decide to get married. So in your case, like this is a concept that we young adults have. I'm not sure how far this holds true, but then we feel that okay, in arranged marriage, there's a big risk because we are marrying someone we don't even know. Even though like today technology is there and you can actually chat with a person or you can actually like know them before taking the decision to marry them. But this was not something that was available 20 years back.
In my era.
Yeah. So like, weren't you scared? Like what if Dr. Jay is not the right person?
Yeah.
Or weren't you scared about that?
The risk you're talking about.
And how did you navigate those fears?
Yeah. So risk, you know. As you said, risk. So everything has a risk in life, you see. Even if you go out of the house, there are a lot of risk, you know. Whatever you do in life is risk. And the most beautiful way of living life is live life dangerously. You need to take risk and you need to take chances, you know. When you are taking a risk, it means you're exploring a new possibility, you know. What if the other side is really green, you know? And you need to accept the insecurity, the risk of life. And in that very acceptance, now you become secure. You really become secure. I said like getting the, you know, the idea behind getting married to a wrong person and what will happen then. So in life, everything changes, you know. the change is the only permanent thing in life. Even if your own body changes, the relationship changes, everything changes, the season changes. So change is the only way of life, I think, and the wrong person can turn into right, even if the right ones can turn into wrong. So that was my idea. And above all, like, I'm a very, not God-fearing, very God-loving person. And my, when your heart is so much full of love and compassion and faith, this like high possibility, you know, you will attract the right soul, isn't it?
That's true. I believe that when you yourself are filled with love and compassion, that energy somehow radiates. And
definitely.
You attract people who are loving and compassionate too.
Who are at the same frequency, you see. Like, every heart is a valley, you know. If you're pouring love into it, it's going to respond, definitely, for sure. It might take some time, but it definitely will respond, you know. And I really believed in, you know, things like, there are certain things which are predestined in your life. How much life you are gifted with, how much education you will get, and the coincidences, you know. And marriage is the biggest coincidence. So I really believed, you know, if I am like, I have so much of compassion, love and faith, I will definitely attract the right person. And we can, of course, fix the little faults. We can always fix the ladies, you know, we can always fix the little tiny faults. So yeah. And the fear, you said? No. I'm an absolutely, absolutely free and fearless soul. I have no fear. No fear from, you know, even from the natural calamities also. I remember when there was this earthquake, I was the only one in my house, living on the third floor, sleeping all alone. Yeah, because I'm absolutely fearless. I believe in taking chances and exploring new things.
So the answer that you just gave reminded me of something that I'd also discussed in the last episode, where I talked about being vulnerable. And it, like, we had this conversation about how, you know, we always tend to look at the negative side of being vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what if things don't work? What if things go wrong? Mm-hmm. We always look at it from that perspective. But the moment we change our frame, and when we start thinking, what if the right things happen? What if my life turns out to be even more beautiful after getting married?
Yes, yeah.
What if my partner is the best person that I can come across?
Yes.
What if my partner is right for me? Maybe if we just change that frame, maybe the process of taking that risk will be easier.
It's definitely your approach, you know, wherever you put your, you know, energy, things will definitely grow. If you are putting all your focus on the negativity, you will definitely have more negativity. You will attract that kind of a situations. That's my view.
So in case of arranged marriages, like, I believe that our parents need to convince us ki bhai shaadi kar le beta.
Shaadi kar lo.
How difficult was it for your parents to convince you to get married?
Not very. I was actually like dying to get married. No, jokes apart. So I told you I'm coming from a strict business family. So there was this trend of getting married early in my family. And my both the sisters, they got married really early, when they were 19 and 20. And I saw them, like, they're living happily, they're settled, and they're happy and satisfied in life. So I thought, yeah, it's not that a bad idea. But of course, at the same time, I wanted to pursue my master's degree, you know. And that was the thing I kept in front of my parents. And they said, of course, you're marrying in a, you know, educated family. The other person will also understand. And it exactly happened that way. They were extremely supportive, very supportive.
So I believe that one good thing that you did in case of, like, before marrying was communicating your needs well.
Absolutely. It was very clear. Very clear from the very beginning.
And I believe that is very important, because sometimes I believe that in the South Asian culture, women are always taught to self-sacrifice.
No.
Because of which sometimes, you know, they forget to put their needs forward, or they sometimes forget to communicate their needs.
Yeah.
And the other person, if they don't even know, if they don't even know your needs, if they have no idea, then how are they supposed to fulfill it? So communicating your needs clearly becomes very important, and that was one smart thing that you did.
I think the best way to receive it, you need to ask for it, isn't it? How are you going to receive if you don't ask for it, you know? I was absolutely clear that I will be working, I will be pursuing my master's degree. Of course, I'm marrying early, but it doesn't matter that I'll sit at home, you know, and doing nothing. So it was very clear. And I was very positive, and they responded in a very beautiful way.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. In case of intercaste marriage, like, I believe that convincing your parents becomes a major hurdle. So as you already stated that the first phase of your hurdle was to convince your parents. So how did you like go through that phase? How did you manage to convince your parents? And how did you deal with all the emotional challenges that might have come across in the process of convincing your parents?
So yeah, it was very difficult for me to convince my parents, especially my mom. Like my dad, he was cool and he had agreed. But like my mom, like even during our college days, my mom used to warn me that love marriage could be allowed in our family, but intercaste marriage, it would be a big no. So you can imagine, right, intercaste marriage in Marbury community, it's a big no. So convincing my mom was difficult because she was getting a lot of pressure from my relatives and extended family. So it was like in the morning, my mom was about to get convinced, but by the time in the evening when I came back home, she used to say, no, 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 we will not allow you to do intercaste marriage, because by the time some relatives would have called her and brainwashed her. So it was difficult convincing my parents, but yeah, my husband, he was a big support for me. I used to get sad and frustrated because they are not getting convinced, but he used to support me and he used to make me calm. So yeah, I think he was like, his role was very much in supporting me and keeping me calm.
So I believe that in this institution of marriage, you also need to know who are you compromising for or who are you taking that challenge for. In your case, you took that challenge so that you could be with your partner, and your partner made it worth it for you as well. Like, he was there to support you. But if you just take that challenge for someone who's not even interested or someone who's not even there, I don't think it's worth it then. So it also matters, like, whom are you taking that challenge
for? Of course, yes.
Like, is that person making it worth it for you or not? So when it comes to marriages, like, I have heard, again, this is something that we discuss about when talking about in friends, and my friends often say that arranged marriage, ma, there's this thrill and excitement because you're exploring a new person every day of your life. But then there's also this misconception that, I believe that it's a misconception, that in case of love marriage, it might get boring after a certain period of time because you already know that person, so it's just the same person, right? So what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I do agree that there is more thrill in the arranged marriage than love marriage, because you know, in love marriage you do somehow know that person. But again, I don't agree with the boring part, that it gets boring in love marriage, because you know that just spending 2 to 3 hours every day with someone and actually living with that person, this both are completely different things. So when you actually live with that person, you get to discover that person every day, you get to learn what are his good habits, what are his bad habits. So sometimes I wonder, like, is he the same guy I had loved before marriage? You know, so you get to discover that person's habits, so get boring.
And in case, what are your thoughts on this?
So as you said, like, you know, the thrill in arranged marriage. Yes, there is thrill, but it comes with the shock, you see. So for me, it was like everything was a shock, you know, country, religion, family, everything. But shock not in a negative way, you know, shock in a positive way. See, me being a doctor, when we give shock to the patient, it brings out the life, you see. So I took shocks positively, in a very positive way, and few with a pinch of salt, of course, but then it was okay. And then the thrill parts, you know. So when I got married 20 years back, I was an intern and I had to go back to complete my internship. And so he was coming like twice weekly to see me, you know. And once my mother even had a doubt if he's a doctor, like, he's spending all his time. How come he's allowed to have so many leaves, you know? And we could spend all the time together. We could go to places. We could go to the places I was not allowed earlier, like to the disco, coming home late at night, spending night outs. So it was, yeah, ticket to the freedom in the beginning, and yeah, a lot of thrill. But as you said, in love marriage, like, they get boring. I don't think so, because I have few friends, they had love marriage, because you don't know the person entirely, as she said, you know. You hardly know the person, you see. When you are living with somebody, you get to see the real colors, the good and the bad, both, of course. So yeah, it's fun in both ways. It's how you see.
I think one of the most important learnings that I have from this answer is that living with someone is a completely different experience.
Yes.
And knowing someone is a completely different one.
Totally.
And in any relationship that you're in, when you're living with someone, you have to learn that, okay, there'll be sacrifices, there'll be changes. And every person is always changing. I'm sure that you're not the same person you were 20 years back.
Yeah, of course I'm not. So you need to see yourself from somebody else's perspective also, you know. It might not be, might not be same, but it might not be wrong also, you know. So you need to see the different shades, you know. And if you keep on defending yourself, you will never be able to bring any transformation in you or in your life. You live same life without any transformation. So you need to see yourself from different angle also, from others' perspective, not only from your husband's side, even from his family side also. And if you take it positively, so of course the result will be positive.
So I believe that, as I said, like one of the most important learnings is that we are always changing. As
yeah.
humans, we are always growing, we are always changing. It's just about, you know, being comfortable with that person.
Yeah.
And accepting their flaws. Like, I believe that it was Mark Manson who wrote this quote, like, more than loving that person, it's about how you see their flaws.
Mm-hmm.
Like how you view their flaws, I guess, really defines how the relationship would look
beautiful.
Like in the long run.
Yes.
So that is very important. Like, how do you see that person's flaws? If you see that that is something completely intolerable to you, then that might become a problem. But if you see that, no, it's okay. If you stop putting that pressure on them to be perfect, the perfect husband or the perfect guy, then the institution of marriage might work better. So what is one of the biggest learnings that you guys have taken from these many years of being married and being in a relationship?
Carry on. Yeah, please carry
so
on.
I think marriage for me is just another term for sacrifice and compromise.
Oh.
You compromise a lot with the person you love. And also in marriage, there are good times, bad times, there are ups and downs. So during down times also, you have to relax and wait for the good times, right? You have to accept both good times and bad times in the same way. And also, I like to put here Sadhguru's quote. He says that no relationship is absolute. It's always variable. You have to conduct it well on a daily basis. So for me, marriage is also like, it's variable. You have to work on it every day. The day you stop working on it, there are chances that your marriage will not work. So you have to put that effort every day.
That's very true. Like, for anything that you do and for an institution like marriage, it's not like a one-time affair that you did your wedding and now it's done. No, you have to take that efforts every day. Being consistent becomes very important to manage any relationship. What about your learnings, Dr. Pooja?
So my learning, it's like it's already been 20 years. So we have spent quite a lot of time together. What I have learned in all these 20 years is like you need to learn to see the bright side, the sunny side of anybody, from people to situation to life. And as I said earlier also, where the energy goes, the thing grows, you know. So if you're focusing on the positive aspect of anybody, there are chances that will grow more and more. And if you're only focusing on the negativity, there are chances of it to be, you know, flourished, isn't it? So if you see the rose flower, if you're focusing only on the thorns, there's a possibility there's a flower, you won't be able to see it only. So you need to learn to see that the bright side. And the other very important thing is you need to conserve your individuality, you know. We are a different individual, you know. Though we are married to each other, but it doesn't mean that I own him or he owns me. You need to do things which you like you like to sing or you like to write or you need to pursue your career. So the individuality is very, very important. And the other thing is like, you know, expectations, you see. So what I have learned and over the period of time, you cannot make anybody the victim of your expectation, and neither you are, you know, you're not there to fulfill anybody's expectations. Yes, we can have we can have our feelings, but you can't put pressure on it. Like, it's not my spouse's responsibility to bring happiness or to make me happy, you know. I need to learn to be happy. happiness is an art. You need to learn to create it. And if you are happy, you can definitely share it with somebody else. But if you are not happy, I don't think so anybody in this world can make you happy. So you need to learn to be happy. And then if two happy people are together in marriage, they can share their happiness. But if you are unhappy and you are getting married, oh wow, now it's his job to make me happy. It's not going to happen. It doesn't happen that way. This is what I have learned. My biggest lesson.
So I believe that this again takes me to Mark Manson's book, because he also talks about like relationships become like really complicated when you consider the other person to be responsible for your happiness.
No.
And when the responsibilities are not clear, like when your only job is to make the other person happy and the other person's job is to make you happy, at that point of time relationships become really complicated. Like really, to keep it simple, you need to understand that you're responsible for your own happiness, and being responsible for yourself becomes very important despite being in the institution of marriage, because you need to know that you're just two individuals sharing life together.
Live life happily, live life dangerously.
So thank you so much, Dr. Pooja and Nishambi, for joining us today. And I believe that this cafe, Bricks Cafe, is the perfect place to be if you also want to see someone, whether it be for arranged marriage or love marriage. Like, this place is really, really cozy. Like, I'm definitely coming here with my partner when I find one. So I'll leave the link to this restaurant in the description box below, so that you guys can go and you guys can come here and check this place out. And thank you so much, Dr. Pooja, and
thank you
for coming here today. I hope this conversation was an interesting one. I'll see you guys in the next episode.